Hi, I'm Michelle Young with USF Health, and we're here today in this Facebook Live with Dr. Christian Brechot. Thank you very much for joining us.
Hello, a pleasure.
We look forward to talking to you today. You always give us a lot of really good information about COVID-19 and the scientific aspect of COVID-19. So thank you.
Thank you.
So let's start with some conversation from your last blog last week about children. And whether there's a lot of debate about whether children are able to spread the virus, carry the virus, and is it something that we should be concerned about moving forward?
Now that's a key question for the dissemination of the epidemics and also obviously when it comes to getting back the kids to school. First, as always, we have to be careful. There are many things that we do not know yet about this virus. But in general, I would say that most of these studies, if not all of these studies, they really concur to let us know that the first, only a handful of kids get infected with severe disease. Most of them, they either will have no infection, or if they have an infection, it will be really without symptoms or with very mild symptoms. So this is good news. And the second good news is that actually when you have some epidemiological studies, for some reasons which are not really clear, it seems that the probability to have a child contaminating an adult is quite low. So now there are some debates. Some studies have pointed to a viral load in children, infected children, which would be comparable actually to that of the adults. Others have claimed that the viral load is much less. But whatever the final answer on this, at the end of the day, the take-home message as for today is the risk of infection is low in children, the risk of disease is low, and the risk of transmission adults is low. So again, good news, but we want to be careful and we will need always to monitor, and test.
And is an adult more likely to spread the virus to a child or vice versa, a child giving it to an adult?
Well, that's a good question, and actually it seems that the adult is more likely to spread to a child than the other way. Why? We don't know. Maybe it has to, it is related to the fact that the kids, they are exposed to many viruses during winter, you see, and there are other human coronaviruses we do not we do not know them because they do not really give disease. So we don't know. Maybe they have a kind of cross immunization. The honest answer is we don't know, but these are the facts as for today.
Terrific. Well, I don't know is a good answer right now during the pandemic, isn't it, at times? So when does it make sense to send kids back to school? Can we do it this summer? Should we wait till the fall? Or should we even wait longer than the fall?
That's a very tough question. And again, we have to be very humble. For example, in France, they have started to relax the containment and the kids went back to school. For the small, the youngest children, you see. In other countries, they have decided to wait until September. It would make no sense, I believe, to wait further than September, you see, because you have to start at one point. I mean, it's not because you are going to wait 6 months that the virus will disappear. We need to learn to live with this virus, you see. We need to cope with it. So the way I see it is that it makes sense to start to reintroduce progressively, very careful, the kids back to school from July, I would say. That's my personal view. Not everybody would agree with this. And I can understand that the parents can be afraid of this, you see, because, but this is why I really believe that everything will go fine. And again, the kid seems really protected. You see, it makes sense to start with young kids, because when it comes to teenagers, that's another story. Because then the risk that they have to get a disease begins to be comparable to that of adults, you see. So I would not start with high school, see. I would really start with the young kids, you see. And then you see what happens. And you need to learn. And this is what, you see, over the next 3 months, we are going to learn from experience.
Yeah, like kids are going to go back to daycare. A lot of young kids, parents that are working, these young kids,
yeah.
Newborns to, you know, 5, 6, 7, 8-year-old kids are going to go
exactly.
back to daycare.
And also, you see, when it comes to, you said, when it comes to getting back to work, how do you want parents go back to work if they cannot have the kids at school? I mean, you see, that's a point.
That's a really, really good point. So how are we doing on flattening the curve in Florida right now? Are we there? Are we past it? We don't know.
Well, we are in a plateau, as I understand, really. We have not really yet come to a real sharp decrease, you see. But clearly, we are in a plateau. Now, we are going to look very, very carefully over the next 2 weeks, because now we have the relaxation of the containment. And because of the incubation period of time, it's only in 2 weeks that we will really see the impact of this relaxation. So I would say so far so good. It will take some time, you see, before we can really get back to a much lower numbers. But that's okay. If we can keep with a plateau and no increase, even though we have started to get back people to a more normal life, that would be already a good success.
Good. So there's a lot of debate. I don't know if you've been out and seen this, but there's a lot of debate about masks right now. Should we wear masks? Should we not? As a scientist and a biologist, where do you stand on wearing a mask?
Very simple, very clear. We should wear masks. There is, for me, no discussion. I hardly understand any discussion on this. It should be obligatory, mandatory to wear a mask. And I believe that somebody in a store who has a client entering without mask should ask for a mask, which is very difficult. But I really believe so. You see, and I wear a mask when I'm outside my home, and I believe we should do that.
Makes sense. So that makes a lot of sense. We wear a mask, wash our hands, social distance, all of that behavior is going to help us in the future.
Exactly. There has been a very large study published by the Canadian Medical Association. They included the different numbers from all countries worldwide on COVID-19. And when they perform a statistical analysis and so on, which are the parameters which show up? Mask, physical distancing, washing hands.
Sounds easy enough.
Yeah.
Okay, so lately we've heard a lot of talk about smart testing. And smart testing, whether it's prisons, nursing homes, packing plants, some of these places where we've had outbreaks of the disease. Can you talk about smart testing, and can we do it prior to there being full-blown outbreaks?
Well, I believe that we need to have this before we have full-blown outbreaks. I mean, because we really need, you see, to take advantage of what we have learned. We have learned a lot over the past 3 months, okay? So we need to take advantage of it. We know that the way to contain a second wave, if we hope not, I mean, this were to come back, you see, it's early identification, tracing, isolation, but diagnostic, tracing for the contacts, isolation. So we have, that's one point. Second, we need to take advantage of this period of time to really investigate different populations within the state of Florida, as well, obviously, as in other states in the US and worldwide. To really, we have now good antibody testing. We have the RNA testing. So now we can really delineate which are the populations which have been hit the most. And obviously that will be very, very helpful. We really need to test. And even if what we hope during the summer, we have a decline, a very sharp decline of the new cases, we need to test so as to have the best overall picture of the situation. And that will be so useful when we will have, but that will not come immediately, but when we will have the vaccines coming, you see, and to design the strategies for vaccination.
Right. So do you think, and this is only speculation, that this virus doesn't like heat? Is that why it's going to go down in the summer? Or is it because we're kind of doing our own thing? What do we know?
Well, maybe both. It seems now that the virus does not like heat, but even more, the virus doesn't like humidity, which is good for Florida. It seems really that it's about humidity even more than the temperature itself. Again, as always, you have some debates. Not all the studies show exactly the same result, but I would say that overall, it's fairly consistent. I really believe that in an area such as the state of Florida, we will have a seasonal variation. And we must, again, take advantage of this, be absolutely fully prepared, so that when winter will come back, we are ready. And that's really the key point.
So before they have a vaccine for COVID-19, do you recommend that people get a flu shot as soon as they can get one in September, October? How important is a flu shot?
I believe that the importance of the flu shot is unchanged. And that's a very good point. You see, you may have both COVID-19 and the flu. And that's not a good situation, you see. No, I really believe that we will recommend from the fall, and really, I mean, to get the flu shot as if COVID-19 would never have existed, you see. I believe it's very important.
Good. And it's good to hear that you believe humidity kills or keeps this virus away, because we definitely have the market cornered here in Florida on humidity.
Absolutely. Now, as always, it's a multi-parametric. If you have humidity and at the same time you behave without being careful, you see, then we will get some infection. So this is, we always come back to combination, mask, physical distance, washing hands, humidity, that will make the job.
That makes sense. So do you think in Florida, we're talking about Florida, that we will continue to flatten the curve? You said it, we've kind of plateaued and we're kind of there. Or do you think that we're going to have a surge? They talk about this surge, a second surge. Is there a possibility of that in Florida? Or do we know yet?
Yes, I mean, again, the honest answer is we don't know. And so we have to brace for the worst. We have to be prepared. But you see, I mean, if you do not have mass gathering, the problem is that if you have mass gathering, you may be in trouble, you see, for example. But if you don't, and if people respect the containment, then we will be fine. But we need to live with this virus. You see, the worst would be to have in June and July a sharp decrease of the number of cases, which would be very good, and then to forget about the virus, you see. And then, yes, we might face a second wave. So we really have to think, okay, the virus situation is getting better. We have the containment being relaxed. That's great. But we do not go back to a real normal life. We go back to a life where we are still careful. We pay attention to this. And then, yes, we may hope to avoid the second wave.
Perfect. That sounds great. So we'll all be careful. So USF is working, USF Health and USF, they're working to develop novel test kits. How is this coming along and how will these novel test kits work?
Well, first, I have really been impressed by what has been happening at USF in general, including obviously USF Health, for the past 1 month and a half, actually. A task force has been gathered. It's incredible, I mean, to see the cooperation, you see. And I'm always keep repeating this. It is true at USF. It is true at the international level. And it's really something which really leads to be optimistic, you see, to be hopeful. Now, within USF, yes, some very interesting proposals have been made. I will not go into detail. It's complex, but it's really using what we call nanotechnologies. It's really a lot of combining engineering and serology. The idea, you see, we have presently very good tests. Now, you see, we have several companies and again, we have good tests. But now the point is to get tests where you do not only evaluate the overall amount of antibodies. You want to know what these antibodies are about. Are these antibodies neutralizing the virus, you see? That means when I will meet again the virus, my antibodies will impair the fixation of the virus on the lung cells and these. So that's really what this test will allow better, you see? So this is what they are working on. The other point is that we need to have very rapid tests, you see? It would be great to have tests that you can perform at home, just a very tiny amount of blood, and you have the result immediately, and you know. And that will happen, you see. But it seems, I mean, always easy to tell, but you have to work hard to get this. So, yes, a lot of excellent projects.
Terrific. Why is contact tracing so critical in fighting COVID-19 and other infectious diseases?
Yeah, and by the way, there are very interesting projects at USF on contact tracing. Because you see, somebody is infected. You want to know immediately, not next week. You want to know who he or she has been in contact with. Well, very easy to tell, but how do you do that? And this is where contact tracing, and this is where South Korea, Taiwan, they have been so good at. If you can in one day, really contact people. Hey, by the way, did you know that you have been in contact yesterday with somebody who turns out to be COVID-19 positive? Don't be afraid, but be tested now. You will be reassured. And if you are positive, I mean, the best chance are that you will develop a very mild disease because, fortunately, severe respiratory disease only happen in a handful of infected individuals. But you know you are positive. This is very important for your family. You can avoid transmitting this to your family. You were planning to meet your grandmother, but nah, let's forget about it for 10 days. You see? So that's contact tracing. As opposed to a burst of infection, and you just learn 10 days after, yes, a guy, what we call patient zero, was positive, but it's too late. So this is what is about contact tracing.
That makes sense. So you've done a lot of interviews with CNN, you've talked with Rolling Stone, you've done a lot of things in the last few months. What do you think your main message with those people, what do you want people to really know about this pandemic and moving forward, because this is not going to be our last pandemic?
Yeah, I believe that what I really want to convey in these interviews is the fact that we can be optimistic, you see. I really believe that we need to get people understand that we will overcome. I mean, you see, the message is really, which is by no means contradictory. We want you to be careful. Yes, it makes, I would say, You are worried, I mean, by the idea to wear a mask when you are outside your home. You are worried by the recommendations on the physical isolation and so on. But that's okay. That's okay. We will overcome. But the message is, on the one hand, everything has been changed with these pandemics, and we have to learn to live with these viruses. And yes, we can do it. Yes, we can do it. So it's not something, it's not the end of the world. I mean, it's not, but yes, we did have a problem and we will have other problems. But so this is really what I'm trying to convey. And obviously, repeating and repeating about the very simple rules to avoid dissemination. Yes.
Terrific. Well, you've done a great job again for us today. We've learned that we need to keep washing our hands, physical distancing, and putting those masks on. That's where we need to go. So thank you so much, Dr. Brechot, for your time. We appreciate it.
Thank you so much. Always a pleasure.